Hello everyone, and welcome to the next video in a three-part series discussing how these three books inspired Mother 3. Today I'll be talking about the second book. Last time I spoke about how The Notebook, the first in this novel trilogy, directly inspired creator Shigesato Itoi, namely the names for his twin characters Lucas and Claus, along with story themes like trauma, abandonment, and military occupation. Today, I'll be talking about its sequel novel, The Proof, which focuses almost exclusively on Lucas's tragic life after separating from his brother. Spoiler warning again, please go play Mother 3, read these books, watch my first video, and come back here. Because who doesn't love prerequisites before watching a YouTube video? Just as a quick recap, the entirety of The Notebook is focused on brothers forced to adapt in a neglectful, abusive environment. Throughout the story, these twins toughen up their bodies and minds through arduous exercises to the point of their becoming desensitized to the war-torn world around them. After Lucas and Klaus's mother is murdered by a bomb explosion, which, by the way, may have at one point been the intended way for their mom to die in Mother 3, as evidenced by this unused cutscene found in the game's data. And after assisting in their grandmother's suicide, the boys are left alone until their father returns for the final two passages of the book. I mentioned his wanting to flee the country after the foreign army's victory by crossing the frontier, because constant surveillance means he doesn't care for his life anymore. He's willing to take the high risk of detonating any of the landmines that make up the border, asking for his son's help in attempting what's said to be impossible, escape. What I didn't mention is that the twins do agree, but not without a plan to benefit themselves, as there is only one guaranteed way to cross the fences without dying, and that is to make someone else go first. So after hearing the bomb explode, one of the twins steps over their father's dead body and crosses while the other stays behind. The twins knew their dad had no chance, so in taking advantage of his reckless abandon, they decided to initiate the last exercise of their regimen, separation. While Mother 3's Lucas and Claus were forced into splitting apart, these brothers in the novel choose to part ways as a final test of will. And it is this decision that The Notebook concludes with, the proof picking up from the perspective of Lucas, who stays behind while his brother lives life in the bordering country. From here on out, The Proof and The Third Lie detail the anguish of their estrangement and the harrowing effect it has on these brothers. The proof begins with Lucas, who, despite being very intelligent, the townsfolk now refer to as the village idiot because of his nervous disorder from the trauma he suffered during the war that ended 5 years ago. He's an outcast, living alone and unsure how to function without his brother by his side. Lucas is physically and mentally ill. He can't eat or drink, vomiting often, is afraid to go into his and Klaus's old room, and neglects the garden because his memory fails him. This dismal state Lucas is in is how I visualize Mother 3's Flint when he becomes obsessed with finding his missing son. The proof's Lucas being shunned by his hometown too reminds me of that same dynamic in Mother 3's Lucas. The boy is labeled a crybaby by his peers, and from chapter 4 onward, he is disdained for rejecting Tasmilly's pig mask influence by not accepting a happy box. The proof's Lucas wanders the streets of the town he grew up in, drinking in bars akin to the dirty cafe, when he stumbles upon a woman trying to drown her baby, but can't go through with it. Lucas later adopts the child, named Mathias, the offspring of an incestuous father-daughter love affair. Mathias was born deformed because Yasmin, his mother, tried to hide the fact she was pregnant by wearing a tight corset. His legs specifically are crippled, which could be, like Harelip, the thief and ally from the first book, an inspiration for Duster. Speaking of, there are a couple of lines in the game that suggest Duster has his limp because of a training accident, under his father Wess's strict discipline. The proofs Lucas similarly pushes Mathias too hard, but in an opposite way, to correct his legs so that he can stand upright and, quote, walk like everyone else, unquote. When they're developed enough to where Mathias can move but with a pronounced limp, Lucas still takes him to the hospital. Much like Wess, though, who expects too much from his son, Lucas loves Mathias and wants the very best for him, believing his method of parenting to be what the child needs to grow. However, Mathias's handicap is much more a point of contention in this story. When Yasmin leaves Lucas and her son for the big city, the child is convinced she did so because he's crippled. With his birth mother gone and father murdered in prison, the child feels that nobody except Lucas loves him, and is often skeptical of even that. Abandonment rears its ugly head again. Mathias is riddled with trust issues, insisting Lucas will leave him at the orphanage and that his mother is dead. Mathias's constant fears and recurring vivid nightmares about losing his family likely resonated strongly with Itoi, because they share a similar mindset. Itoi, for example, revealed his worst nightmare involving all his friends and family becoming evil. This psychological torment was brought to life with the hallucinations of Claus and Flint on Thane Island. With Mathias now old enough to attend school, the cruelty he endures is appalling. Kids verbally and physically abuse him because of the way he looks, but also because of his mental aptitude. The only person Mathias seems to admire then is Agnes, a kindergarten teacher the child likely sees as a potential mother figure, and as such tries to pair her with Lucas. Unfortunately though, after it's learned that Agnes has a beautiful, blonde little brother that really reminds Lucas of Claus, Mathias becomes overwhelmed by the idea that Lucas could easily have a real family of his own, seeing the three of them as a perfect match. Mathias then, at the age of 7, dejected with no hope of Yasmin's return, decides to hang himself next to the skeletons Lucas kept of his mother and baby sister. At age 7, Mathias joins them by committing suicide. This, of course, utterly defeats Lucas. Stricken with grief, he becomes a mute, slumping into a worsened depression, and sleeping on the child's grave every night, because the best place to sleep is the grave of someone you'd loved. Years pass like this, and at age 30, Lucas finally disappears from town. If that wasn't enough of an age jump, the end of the story transitions 20 more years from that moment to the perspective of a 50-year-old Claus just arriving by train. As Claus searches for his brother in the town they grew up in, he's eventually given the notebook Lucas has been adding to since the first novel, which by this point has expanded into 5 large notebooks. It documents Lucas's life, and serves as the sole proof of his existence. Lucas went into hiding 2 decades ago because the dead body of a woman near the riverbank of their grandmother's old house was discovered, the body of Yasmin. Claus never contacted Lucas because he couldn't. Their test had to be a total separation. The border wasn't enough, so silence from both parties was necessary. However, it has been too long. Claus is exhausted. Claus is ill and wants to see his brother again, but now he can't. The book concludes then with Claus taken into custody, having waited for his brother with an expired visa extension and now invalidated identification. But what's strange is that the authorities are not able to verify any record of Lucas or Claus living in town, and reveal that the notebook looks like it was written by Claus himself in one sequence over a short period of time. They state the manuscript to be a work of fiction, as neither the events described nor the characters portrayed ever existed in this town. The sole exception is Claus's grandmother, who may have been entrusted with the care of one or more children. This trippy ending sequence implies that all of what happened throughout these last two books were lies. It's events either fictitious or different than what was already established. It's a bombshell of a revelation, so unexpected it feels as if the author's betraying the reader, betraying me, since all of what I've read up until this point has been presented as fact while it was happening. How can I trust then what the third and final novel has to say? And what is it called? The Third Lie. This idea of betraying the reader, where have I heard that before? Oh, right. A desire to betray the player. Those are Itoi's exact musings in this massive Mother 3 interview. In context, they're discussing the game's original script back when it was slated for release on the N64, which supposedly had a scenario that dug in a direction that would purposely upset people. While Itoi could be referring to anything narratively, I'm reminded of a plot twist we did get, very likely inspired by the proof's unexpected reveal. So, let me explain. In Mother 3, it's eventually revealed that the denizens of Tasmanly are all living their lives as a lie. As Leader explains in a long-winded speech, everybody we've met throughout this adventure are actually the last remaining survivors of the world. It's not stated exactly how the Earth was ruined, just that humans were the cause. But nevertheless, the few survivors from this event boarded a white ship and fled to the setting of Mother 3, the Nowhere Islands, as the sole remaining haven in the world. These refugees all agreed to wipe the memories of their lives before the islands, in fear that they would repeat humankind's mistakes and ruin this world too. Everybody opted to take up new identities and ideal roles for a fresh start, a better, simpler life than they once had. While this is obviously a more fantasy approach, the idea of a grand reveal of a truth that changes everything is apparent in both the game and book series. The Third Lie helps explain the book's plot twist and finishes out my videos on the series' relationship with Mother 3. There are even more shattering revelations to come that tie into the game's themes, arguably even more so than they already have, and will wrap up my points like a gift box near the train tracks. Join me next time for the finale, and I'll see you next time. Thank you.